Right now, and we're live, Gordon.
Hey, Internet, we are here, and I'm going to say this, even though it really makes me feel kind of dated, but we have at least 100 years of gaming right in front of us on the screen. If you're watching this stream, it feels like 100 years of gaming, right? Definitely.
Oh, agreed. At least 100 years, I should say.
We look so good, though. It's all the moisturizer.
And the lighting.
Well, you do the virtual, you know, smooth your skin over stuff. Yeah, so I don't even try. It just gives up on me. So, but we're going to have some awesome content today. We're talking about old school gaming. You know, we're going back to the 90s, the 2000s of gaming, you know, the golden age of gaming in a lot of ways.
And before.
Oh, and before. Yes, and before. And we have Major Nelson, Larry Hyrb. I'm practicing his name so I don't screw it up. So the H is soft. Larry Hyrb, right?
That's fine. That'll do, Gordon. It's fine.
We have Kelt, Reeves with Falcon Northwest and Frank Azor. See, I'm practicing all the names so I don't screw this up.
Hey, everybody.
Hello, Gordon.
Hello.
So, get some questions ready, but I have a ton I've sent over, and we're going to be talking about everything from DOS gaming to original DirectX, Windows 95 gaming, and on and on, and what the PC used to be like. If you're new to PC gaming and you think you just simply woke up and you got the latest, best, awesome, highest frame rates and beautiful graphics and all the stuff, it wasn't always this way. It was a fight to get here. And the reason I love to do this is because looking at this, the people we have on the screen, it reminds me it really was a difficult battle to get here to where we are in the state of modern day gaming and kind of what gaming actually means to the audience. I mean, the saying is always we stand on the shoulders of those before us. And I think we are here because of the three guests we have on the show that got the football down the field to get us where we are today. So.
Nice.
I would include you in that, Gordon.
Yeah, absolutely.
The four of us.
Well, when you're just see the nice thing is when you're in the media, we just get to, you know, we get to push out the hot air, so we get to blame people, but we don't get to actually have to do any work. We don't do any creating. So that's the best thing about being on the media side of this whole thing. So,
but if it wasn't for you saying nice things about Falcon Northwest and Alienware PCs, we certainly wouldn't be here. So we definitely appreciate you, Gordon.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, thanks for. I mean. Over 20 years ago, you recognized what we were trying to do. And even though things weren't always perfect, you recognized it, you respected it, and you gave us credit for it. And we're definitely here because of your help. So don't diminish your value in this industry, my friend.
Yeah, and Gordon, from the software side, you know, you've been so helpful for Microsoft, which is, you know, has been at the center of gaming for so long. So it's, you know, we're kind of the three-legged stool here, all of us.
Should we kick this off, Adam, or is everything working?
We should kick us off. Yeah, we got all the friends of the show in the chat. I think everything's up and running good. We do have already some requests to talk about the original physics cards, 3D effects voodoo. You know, there's a lot of people here who remember the good old times. So yeah, nice. I think we are ready to roll then, Gordon. Let's go ahead whenever you are ready.
Okay. I'm trying to think of what I'm saying because I didn't write any notes, but we'll try to just wing it. So it means I'm going to screw this
up. Live.
Ready?
Yep, go for it.
In this episode of Full Nerd, old school gaming. Welcome to a very special episode of The Full Nerd. I'm your host, Gordon Mong, with some very, very special guests. I'm not going with any favoritism, but I'm going to go from box to box on my screen. First, it is Kelt Reeves of Falcon Northwest.
Hello, Gordon.
And then it is Major Nelson or Larry Hyrb, of course, of Xbox fame.
Gordon, how are you? Great to see you. Thank you for having me.
Great, great. Doing great today. I'm so glad you're here. And of course, we have Frank Azor, who is now at AMD. And of course, his roots go back to the old days of gaming as well with Alienware.
Hey, everyone. Thanks so much for having us.
Thanks for coming. And I want to kick this off in, you know, I originally had the first question that I wanted to ask, what was your favorite game? But I kind of want to ask now, because I'm really excited just to have you all here, but do you think, I want to talk about DOS gaming, because I think that era of gaming is very special in everybody's hearts. And I'm going to wrap that in on the first question. What is your first DOS game that you played that you loved so much?
I mean, I can jump in here a little bit. It feels a little weird because, you know, you talk specifically about DOS. I remember playing growing up in Connecticut, playing Microsoft Flight Simulator 1.0, which was an incredible experience. If you remember, this was if I recall correctly, Gordon and the rest of the panel, if you would correct me, I'm pretty sure it was on a self-bootable disk as well. So I'm not sure if that actually counts.
For some reason. Well, I guess everything, because everything had to fit on that 360K floppy. So I guess,
right. Yeah. But that was the one that I remember the most, and seeing the green outline of the Sears Tower as you're going into Meigs Field. That to me, I mean, I felt like I was flying. It was because a lot of it that I like to remember is certainly we had these low def graphics on screen versus what we have today. But a lot of it is in here. Our minds had to fill in the blanks, and really, it was kind of the seamless melding of what we had in our mind and what we saw then on the screen.
Yeah, that imagination fills it all in. Although yeah. I will have to say, the current flight simulator kind of like, that whole like whenever you get the old farts, like, oh, I remember my imagination was so much more vivid than you look at actually flight sim today. It's like, oh, okay, actually.
Yeah, actually, wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
Larry, what about Kelt? What about you?
Say, Larry, I can see your oldness and raise you even older. I brought a few props, I feel like Carrot Top with the props here today, but there's some MS-DOS 3.1, the first games that I played, you had to type them in yourself out right. of a book in DOS. And I'm going to show the kids some of this. So this was the manual for how you had to program your own game. And then at the back, 5 1/4 floppies.
They don't know what that is.
This is why the save icon looks like it does right there. That's what that came from. But yeah, I started out with a TRS-80 Model 1, a Trash 80, it was called. And this was 78, 79.
So you had the cassettes, right?
Believe it or not, my dad got this from Radio Shack, which is where you got your candies.
Right.
He got it with no storage medium of any kind, not even the cassette drive. So I would spend hours typing in the lamest game you could imagine in DOS, spend 10 minutes playing the horrible result of what I typed in. And then when I turned the computer off, it was gone. A year or two later, we finally got a little micro cassette drive. But yeah, the first games were you know, text. And then, you know, eventually you could go to the hobby stores and buy games like Zork. And those kind of things were usually in Ziploc bags.
Yeah.
On a pegboard.
In the back of the store.
It was very hobbyist back then. But those were the first games you could buy. We were happy.
That, you know, that's funny. That is a parent thing, because my first computer was a VIC 20 bought at Toys R Us.
Nice.
And we did not get the cassette either, because like the parents are like, no, I'm getting the computer.
Yeah. It's all done. We're done.
You pay for the storage, you know. It's like, what? I'm like a kid. I can't afford it. But Frank, what about you? What's your memorable DOS game that you still wax poetic about?
My first, I would say, like kind of like graphically intense DOS game was Lynx 386, that golf game. If you guys remember that,
yeah.
In the early 90s. That was the first time I saw graphics in a game that I was like, this is pretty fascinating. Because before that, it was similar to Kelt's story where it was text-based stuff, or it was Ultima, that kind of stuff. You didn't really see graphics, or the graphics you did see were ASIC characters, and it was very primitive. But Lynx was the first one that I owned. I mean, I had played some other games and stuff, but that's, I think, the first one that I owned. But the one that I can remember now that was right, I think it was one of the last DOS games that I remember playing was Command & Conquer Red Alert. That was like one of the last ones, I think, and that had like real motion video in it, and for, it was, that was impressive. That was an awesome experience.
Yeah, incredible soundtrack for that too, if I remember.
Yeah. You know what's interesting, Gordon, is you're talking about, we're talking about graphics and DOS, but you know, when we talked about that golf game, we also remember there was a time, and I can't remember exactly when it was, where the audio was no more bleeps and bloops, where we had actual, we had the golf swing, or we had, you know, we had a voice clip. And
but
and
you had to buy a sound blaster sound card.
Yeah.
It was expensive. It was like $100, I think.
Yeah. You got that MIDI soundtrack.
Yeah. And then you needed speakers, because before that it was the PC speaker, and you would hear little beeps and bloops and whatever coming out of the PC. Believe it or not, folks who don't know what we're talking about, desktop computers used to have speakers built into them. But not like the speakers you have now. It was just it was a speaker, and it was like a prompt. It was like a beep kind of thing. It was very weird. It's hard to describe it, even though it's so primitive.
It was like Morse code back then, right?
It was. And don't you remember, like, I can't remember, wasn't it, Wolfenstein, where they were able to digitize the audio, where it probably took like, you know, it took over all the resources just to play one small digitized clip.
Yeah, or you Duke Nukem on some.
I still remember Wolfenstein saying, "Halt, Schweinhund!"
Yeah, those are all. I mean,
I was amazed by that. That's why I remember it.
Wolfenstein was DOS. I think the original Doom was DOS too, if I remember correctly. Yeah. And this is a long time ago, so my memory may not be perfect. But yeah, I think those were all DOS as well. I remember on discs. Actually, another game that was very impressive to me on DOS was Wing Commander. And I had the speech pack, and the speech pack was, to your point, Gordon, the speech pack was 5 3.5-inch floppy disks, but the whole game was 6 disks.
Yeah.
So the speech took almost as much space as the whole game. And I think that's the one that had Mark Hamill in it, if I remember correctly. Yeah.
That was 3.
Wing Commander 3 was the one. Okay. Yeah. That was pretty impressive.
I remember that because that was my demo at Comdex in, I think 95.
Was it?
People are furiously searching what Comdex is right now.
Yeah. That was a, for people who don't know, Comdex was a computer show in Las Vegas and held in every November. And it was basically CES before CES got big. And then, of course, it sort of faded away in the late 90s, I think. Maybe early 2000s.
Busted, yeah. Just kind of caved in.
Do you, like, the funny thing is, like, we take it for granted that, like, audio, something as just simple as audio now. And that was a huge, huge, you had to buy a separate sound card if you want higher end audio. And and it was a major resource in space, because, you know, you couldn't really, there were no MP3s, and you couldn't really decompress it easily on the fly with the CPU because they weren't powerful enough. But
it's just
one another thing that reminds me, like, wow, we just take that so granted, like, for like nothing.
And initially, when the transition from DOS to Windows was occurring, there was a while there where certain sound cards didn't work in Windows. They only worked in DOS. And then others worked in DOS. They didn't work in Windows. And we had a configuration at Alienware where we had one sound card output piping into the input of another sound card so that you can have two sound cards in your system and play all your DOS games with sound and your Windows games with sound. It was so complicated back then, and it was not the most reliable configuration, as you can probably imagine.
Well, but I also want to point out, to your point, Frank, is that not just with game developers, but even folks like yourselves and create, you know, folks that build systems like Help, is there was immense creativity. We kind of were in the early days, kind of like the Apollo astronauts were like, oh, we've got all these things. We got to figure something out. We want audio. How do we do it? And how do we connect it? Maybe we knew the hardware, but we didn't know the software, or vice versa. But there was this drive because we knew where we could see where things were going. It was really exciting.
Yeah, it was exciting, but it was really hard. Like, building a computer today is so easy compared to what it was 20 years ago. Two sound cards, you had a 2D video card, you had 3D video cards on top of the, and chassis had to be huge because you still had CD-ROMs, DVD-ROMs. Then you had some, remember we had the front panel audio, that Creative made a front panel, so that would take up a 5 1/4-inch bay.
Or the Roland MIDI cards, you know, or, in addition to the sound card.
Or you could get, like, if you were doing any digital video at the time, you'd have front connectors. So we had these towers that were like, massive. I mean, how tall were those things?
Well, you had to fit your zip drives and your jazz drives.
Zip drive, jazz drive.
And brown components, they're coming back.
And every PCI Express, well, there was no PCI Express, sorry, every PCI slot was occupied.
Yep. Yeah, remember? I was going to bring it up because if you look up a 1990s enthusiast gaming rig, it was just every PCI slot was full, right? Every single one. It was crazy.
It was,
Gordon, I can see your oldness and raise you. Every Visa local bus slot.
Oh, and then to that point, and that's like what Larry was saying. Then you had all this hardware, but then you had to go into the operating system and start doing IRQ strings,
or DMA strings, files.
Yes, and make sure there was no conflicts. We used to have to go in and edit registries all the time. Kids don't know how good they have it nowadays.
Don't forget your SST statements for your 3DFX card.
And you know, the other thing too is it's funny because we, in the modern era, people get really caught up in the battles. Like it feels like, oh, everything's such a fight. Like you got to have this fight to that. You know, they're always fighting over these. Like I think back to the earlier days and they really were battles. Like you had sound cards, you had like Aureal 3D, you had Sound Blaster, and everybody, you had 3DFX. Everybody wanted to establish and get in front of their competitors because if you could do that, you had this huge advantage. But
yeah, you were the standard.
Yeah, because you if you develop that momentum, your competitors couldn't catch you, and all the game developers are like, well, you've got the market share. We're going to do 3DFX. We're going to do this or that, and then you basically own the market and you can charge what you wanted. So yep. Everything back then was a real battle where, you know, a lot of people sort of think it feels like today's kind of wars feel pretty minor compared to that, where if some one vendor owned something, they literally owned it.
Yeah, well, it's also, go ahead, Frank.
I was just going to say, you're right. There was, yeah, today we think about there being two graphics card providers and, you know, three and the third one coming up, but we had like eight back then, if not more. And we had, you know, mostly everything is played today primarily on, you know, right, DirectX and a little bit of Vulkan out there. But we had OpenGL, we had Glide, which is 3DFX standard. You had DirectX coming up, and I'm sure there's others out there but things were really complicated. It was a tough time.
Yeah.
Barriers of entry were lower too. Like it was easier for a company to make graphics cards back then than it is today. And I think, you know, that was good in some sense, but also a challenge because of the complexity we all had to manage.
But I was just going to say this. What's also interesting is we forget because it's become so normalized is the cycles. And in other words, you know, I could see something from Gordon posting about a video card or some piece of technology, and that's happening real time. We had to go to the corner computer store or sign onto a BBS to check it out because this is pre-internet. So the information was much more fractured and things moved a little much slower in terms of how we found out. I only could go to the computer store once every 2 weeks because it wasn't even in my town. So I just, you know, just getting that knowledge base. And of course, we also, you know, try to go to the library and read up on computer magazines, Byte Magazine and all the rest of them, right?
Yeah. Now you bring up BBSs. Most people probably don't know what those are. They have no understanding. How would you even explain that today? It's like,
Mom, hang up the phone.
Yeah. I mean, it's like remoting. It's like dialing into another person's computer or maybe a very small network of computers back then, and each one had a node that you would dial into, and there would be files shared and a kind of the early beginnings of a mess. Imagine Reddit, but instead of it sitting on the entire internet, it sat on like one computer
under some guy's desk somewhere.
And only the people that had like four modems or three modems, so you had multiple people dialing in.
And only the people that had access, the phone numbers to that BBS, and if it was free, the free, or if they had a paid subscription, could they talk to one another on that specific one individual server.
And they knew how to dial in ADTT space, star 70, comma, et cetera, et cetera.
Exactly. Remember that? You used to have to know all the phone company's commands.
Man, I can't believe you remember the modem dial-up strings. That's just...
I'm a phone nerd, and I'll tell you that whole story on another podcast. So
I think Sorry, you just I dropped admitted there, to guys.
You were talking about the old days when things didn't work right.
We were talking about BBSs for a second there, if you remember those. And try, how would you describe a BBS to to somebody today, Kel, that didn't live through that?
So here's how old I am. I don't remember the term. a bulletin board system?
Yeah, bulletin board system.
Oh, BBS. So that,
yeah.
So that's mainly how I got my my real start in college. I was pirating so many video games.
It's we're past statute of limitations now. You could say that. It's okay.
Over a local BBS eventually the moderator of the BBS said, like, he was running a US Robotics 16.8 modem. I mean, you know, the really fast one. But I was pirating so many games. He was just like, dude, where are you? Why don't you come over and get them on floppies? It turns out he was in the next apartment complex over. For the last 24 years, he's been Falcon's vice president. So it worked out in the end. We now we now buy games. I brought a boxed copy of Doom.
Thank
on
you.
Floppy. I for a while it was unopened because everyone had Doom. No one had bought it. But I've since made good. I've gone and apologized with PCs to the game gods like Chris Roberts and Richard Garriott, who you know, back when I was a penniless college student and pirated all their games. It took 20 years, but I went through a piracy penancy project with those guys.
I think they did okay. I think they're doing just fine.
You know, I have a question here because it is interesting. Originally, you know, computers were made for business use, right? That's how they sold. They wanted to sell them to companies and small business people to use. And for some reason, it was just natural for people like, oh, how do I play games in this thing? Even before games existed. And it's like, it's some kind of natural urge with humans where you want to take every single tool and how do I make a game out of this? Because those early computers, especially PCs, they were, you know, IBM made them to make money off businesses. And somehow they turned them, you know, the average person, you know, the hobbyist turned them into gaming machines.
But those first early years, that was not something that people were proud of with their PC. Even though we were advertising, you know, here's a PC designed to play games, that was not what people would admit to back then. It was very much a kind of closeted hobby, if you will. People would call us up because, you know, there was no interwebs then. People would call us up out of our, you know, print ads and Computer Gaming World and PC Gamer. And a lot of them, even if they read gaming hobbyist magazines, it was kind of like, you know, you were using a $3,000 piece of business hardware to goof off on.
Yeah.
It wasn't something you were proud of. And people would sometimes start the calls with us with, like, I'm ashamed to admit it, but mainly I use my PC for gaming. I have to say, you know, sir, it's okay here. You're the word safe space didn't exist back then. But to tell them, you know, you're among friends. We actually design these to play games on. It's okay if, you know, all you do is goof off of this. You don't have to pretend you bought it for your business.
Yeah, Kel, to that point, we had when I worked in radio in Connecticut in the 90s, we got our PCs, and every evening the three or four nerds in the radio station would get together, and after, you know, we closed down Lotus 1-2-3, we would try to figure out how to do a LAN, and it was crazy. But it also, what you just described also brought into another invention that a lot of people listening or watching may not remember, and that of course is the boss mode or boss key, right? And a lot of people may not remember that, where you had a special keystroke so that if the boss walked in, it looked like you're working on the spreadsheet, right?
Yep. I often tell my employees as I walk past them and I see that, you know, alt tab happening, I'm like, dude, I've been boss keyed by the best of them. You know what it means.
Yeah, that is literally a thing. For people who don't know, there was a command or a key on your keyboard you would press, and a fake spreadsheet would come out, or a fake word processing thing would come out.
You would sit there and you try to slow your breathing down because you obviously were worked up. Now you're like, okay, I breathe normally, because you would not be that excited about a spreadsheet. So.
About a report.
I do actually have a really good question from the chat. Friend of the show, Flash Photos, asking, can you ask Kelt and Frank what got them to start a PC company around gaming when it used to be viewed as taboo and like such a small market?
Kelt, you were first, buddy. You were before Alienware, so I'll let you start.
Sure. I distinctly remember in college reading computer gaming world, which I'd read for years. And again, that was the, you know, closet nerd, you know, less than 100,000 circulation only gaming magazine in existence, really, back then. This was, you know, late 80s. And I was looking through there and noticing that no one had ever advertised a computer in computer gaming world. And it was just because, again, it was not a hobby that anyone was proud of. You didn't, you know, admit that you were using your business PC purchase to goof off on. Even myself, my Apple IIe at the time, where I did most of my gaming, I had to, in college, you know, convince my parents that my Apple IIe just wasn't keeping up for my schoolwork. You know, I just, I don't know, the typing the term papers just, you know, didn't seem to go fast. I don't know how I justified it, to be honest. I'm glad I did, because now I have a career. But back then, the real reason that I wanted to move to PC, and this was, you know, 88, 89, was Ultima 5 had come out with VGA graphics. I'd never seen anything like that. So basically, when I was about to get out of college, I spent years getting a degree in aeronautical science and lots of piloting licenses, which are just on my wall. No one needed pilots after the first Gulf War. And so I figured if I didn't make my own job, I wasn't going to have one. And so I decided, hey, nobody's tried to sell a PC in computer gaming world. So that was 92, 93. And, you know, I'm 31 years later, I am here talking to you luminaries. So the 100 grand my parents spent on, you know, aviation college did not work out. But the goofing off and talking them into getting a PC, that worked out.
Well, I'll tell you guys, when was it? Last week, Nelson, the founder and the CEO of Alienware, and I did a podcast on NPR. Guy Raz, if you've ever heard of his podcast, How I Built
Marketplace, sure.
Yeah. So the How I Built This podcast, it just came out. And you can hear, if you want to hear more history about Alienware and the findings of it, it's a really good hour and 15 minutes to just hear how Nelson came up with the idea and everything. But one of the things he says in the podcast is just how influential Kelt was on everything that he did. And, you know, Nelson originally had a regular computer company, if you will, non-gaming computer company. But he kept getting requests from friends and family around getting the computer that could play these games. Again, in that closet kind of fashion, like, don't tell anybody, but I also want this thing to play games. And eventually he came across a Falcon Northwest ad and said, wow, look at these guys. They're selling these computers in this magazine. I'm going to try and do the same thing. And that was how it happened. I mean, Kelt is the OG of selling gaming computers via magazine, if your advertisement or over the phone. And then, you know, Alienware followed through pretty quickly thereafter. But yeah, it's pretty crazy to think about, like, that's how we used to do it back then. We used to advertise and you'd have to pick up the phone and call and speak to a stranger and then give them
your credit card,
of your money, thousands of dollars of your money, adjust that for inflation. And just imagine, like, we were selling computers back then for $4,000, $5,000, $6,000. I mean, Kelt still sells them for that amount today and more, but adjust that for inflation, just to give you an idea. I mean, you could buy a car for about that back then, and you're blindly giving somebody your credit card information, and then they're telling you it's going to show up in a few weeks. You're hoping and praying that this company you've never heard of before is going to make
an industry you've never heard of.
Exactly, is going to make do on their promise and actually send you what you've been eagerly anticipating here, and that you've already paid for 20, 30, 40 days in advance. It was a different time, completely different time.
It is so funny that it just was not seen as something a normal person did, though, you know, and it was just a side thing that
do we
that
look everybody... normal to you, Gordon? Does anybody here look?
Well, you know, I want to get into the next phase of gaming, PC gaming, especially where I think, you know, we had gone through all these wars where every hardware vendor was trying to get a leg up over the other hardware vendor for their own advantage, and it feels like the next era that really kind of changed the course of PC gaming, in a lot of ways gaming, was the introduction of Windows 95 and DirectX, right? Because you know, for people who don't know, well, I guess everybody watching this or listening knows DirectX is an API that you play games on. But back then, again, you had each company with their own API and they didn't work with each other's APIs. And it was a nightmare for game developers because they'd have to make them for every single product and validate them for all of that stuff. And Windows 95 felt like, and DirectX felt like, it was that turning point in the history of PC gaming. Would you three agree? Or
definitely?
Yeah, absolutely. It definitely helped solve those problems, which were huge problems. And just to give you an idea of the consequence of those problems that DirectX solved, if you owned a 3DFX graphics card that, let's say, I think it only supported Glide at the time, if I remember, that was the API, Glide, but you bought a game that was an OpenGL game, right? Or a DirectX game, but mostly it was really an OpenGL issue. That game just wouldn't work on your graphics. You just could not play that game on your computer. And for a lot of people that aren't technical, that's, you buy the game at the store, like Larry was talking about. You went to your store, you may have driven an hour or more to go get it. You paid a lot of money back then. It could have been $40 or $50 back then, which would be probably equivalent to over $100 today for this game. You installed it because it would install, and the install could have meant 10 discs that you went through, one of two or one
of 10.
An hour. Then you patched the game, and to find a patch, remember how you used to have to go to these weird, obscure websites to try and find the patch?
Yep.
And just hope and pray that they didn't have a virus inside the patch. Then you patch the game, you hope that the patch loaded correctly, and then you go to open up the game and it says, oh, not compatible with your system after all that. I mean, that was the PC gaming experience in the late 90s.
I'll tell you, Frank, and to build on that a little bit, imagine you did that, but imagine while you're on disc like 8 of 12, and because remember, they shipped with manuals back then, and you'd get to like the end, because you're getting nothing to do, so you're rating and you're reading the manual, and you get to the end, you get to the compatibility page, you're like, uh-oh. And you realize, so instead of getting the error, you're like, oh, wait a minute, you're down on your hands. Oh no, I have this. And then everything goes south, right?
Yeah, and then not all stores would take the game back because they assumed you pirated it.
Yeah.
So now you have these floppy disks for a game that they assumed you pirated, and they wouldn't take the return, and you're out all this money. And DirectX started to really help solve many of those problems. Kelt, you were going to say something? Sorry.
Do you remember when in the manual, and yes, Doom had a manual, believe it or not, for, you know, as complex as it was. Do you remember in the manuals when they would actually have certain code words on the bottom of the pages where to prove that you got a legit copy, you would have to have the manual and type in the secret word from, it would prompt you, go to page 8 of your manual.
Yep.
Well, not only the keys. Word.
The keys.
Okay, that was piracy control back then.
Yeah, and in fact, remember who did that, who had fun with that was Infocom with their games, because they had the physibles, those things that usually, you know, contributed to the game, and, you know, Witness would have one, you'd pull it out, and what's the name of the on the back of the matchbook. I have no idea. I don't have the matchbook, right? Mm-hmm. It was a different take on that.
Different types of piracy control. Yeah. DirectX really just changed everything, and it changed that was our first step into legitimacy in PC gaming. So this tiny company in Oregon with, you know, a handful of employees, we got approached by Microsoft from some guys you may have heard of, Larry, Alex St. John and Jason Robar.
Yep.
Came to us, and they were basically like, we want to, I think it was called, that was the Games SDK, Game Software Development Kit back then. We want to basically ensure that all the games run on all the gaming PCs. And so they had us up to the Embassy Suites in Redmond, Washington. And we sat there for a weekend along with every other PC manufacturer, each in a suite. And the Microsoft guys and all the game developers brought beta copies of their games with the DirectX API around to the different suites to run on our PCs just to see if they could work out compatibility bugs. And we were really thrilled because nobody had any problems with our stuff. It was also a really, really boring weekend because, you know, nothing exciting happened, no bugs to solve. But I remember just sitting around in a hotel room going, oh, so that's DirectX. Huh? The little fox runs really quickly across the screen.
Did it change? I mean, because as you were hardware vendor selling, you know, mostly game machines for DOS, and then post DirectX, did it sort of make it a lot easier to sell machines? And I'm sure it must have made the support less of a headache.
Not at first. There was a huge, it was definitely a lot of teething pains. But DirectX was kind of the first effort by a huge company to standardize things. And, you know, Windows 3.1 as a gaming platform, it was a joke. You know, real gamers were DOS.
Yeah.
Frank, you remember that. It was, you know, it was nobody gamed on Windows. And so it was a huge effort from Microsoft to make DirectX and Windows 95 then a gaming platform. And so I said, when you're ready for the long story, I can tell you the story behind this 27-year-old bottle of Microsoft soda that I got on the night DirectX officially took over.
I'm so jealous of Kelt souvenirs. He is a much better collection than anything I have.
What does the label say on that, Kelt?
So this is, if you guys are ready for this story, everybody had their coffee, because this is a long, weird one. But this is Microsoft Brainwash Soda, which was given out at a massive event. It was the event that launched DirectX 1 on Windows 95. Windows 95 launched, and they still had a lot of work to do to basically, you know, convince people. So I got this at the Judgment Day 1995 Halloween party, which was in the Microsoft parking garage. And Microsoft had hired some type of Hollywood type production company, spent, word was, you know, over $1 million, turning the Microsoft parking garage into a haunted house, where they had invited all of the DOS game developers that they were trying to woo to DirectX, like id Software and Activision, trying to basically give Windows gaming a coming out party. And so they got the guys at id Software to, I think, manage a lot of it, and id merged a popular, I think it was like one of the first esports networks. It was called Duango. They were running a Doom Deathmatch, and they wanted to have the championship of the two best, esports wasn't even a term then, the two best Doom head-to-head players have their finals on stage at the Microsoft Judgment Day Haunted House. And it was sort of this weird mix of one of the first big esports tournaments, along with a Microsoft sort of sponsored trade show, with all of the game developers coming in, setting up Halloween sort of themed booths in the haunted house, and a haunted house party hosted by Jay Leno. I missed that part because I was in the back doing setup. And this was one of the strangest, weirdest parties, and probably the event that got Microsoft to be to have the reputation of being very cautious since. I even had to go Google to refresh my memory on some of this that I didn't know of, like Alex St. John getting kicked out of his own event evidently happened there. But let's see, what should I start with? So it was mainly a gaming trade show, and they'd invited companies like Activision, id to set up not booths, but haunted house areas in the parking garage. And so it was like this incredibly high budget, you know, best haunted house that you could ever imagine. So I remember Zombie Studios had this like huge Tesla coil, you know, the kind you'd see in the movies. And they had like this, you know, fake zombie there. And they were like, you know, zombie brand zombies, the best zombies. That was their, you know, their booth. And Activision did a big jungle theme, you know, basically created a jungle in the parking garage for Pitfall, the Mayan adventure. And then the weirdest one, and I remember this one distinctly, id Software handed their booth over to the band Guar, which was a costumed, like, acid metal. I mean, Kiss has nothing on the costumes these guys have, just like literally monstrous. Their booth, I remember, was filled with like fake blood styrofoam that we had to crawl through while the band was there playing, throwing stuff at you, yelling at you. Guar dripped blood on me. Got through that, and then very late into the evening was the esports tournament. And one of the big reasons why we were there is we were going to present a $10,000 gaming PC to the winner of the Doom Deathmatch 95. And the event had kind of gone off the rails. We'd come up from the haunted house. The band that was evidently an id favorite, they had dressed like the Pope, Jesus, and Satan, and were evidently playing stuff that was so off the rails that Alex St. John was fighting with his PR people about whether, like, evidently they pulled their mics. They tried to shut them down. Alex St. John had evidently tried to get them, you know, back. They were playing through the tournament. I didn't know about this part, but I read it on the Doom Wiki that Alex St. John had had an argument with his boss and gotten kicked out of his own event. And the band played on. The tournament went on late into the night. The id guys were all very well into their cups, as you'd say, but then shouting just things like "more carnage" at the players. And eventually, Dennis, aka Thresh Fong, won the Doom Deathmatch 95, and I presented him with the $10,000 Mach 5 gaming PC. And I think he might have been the start of the first esports star back then.
Wow, yeah,
that was quite a journey.
Probably Microsoft's wildest night. The sequel event had evidently gotten canceled. And Larry, I am very interested to know if any of those people, again, a lot of this is my own recollections mixed with the stuff I didn't see and read on the Doom Wiki. Oh, right. I almost forgot Bill Gates appearing in Wind Doom. One of the starts of the actual presentation of the esports was some footage of Doom. Bill Gates being green screened into that, yep. Very, very awkwardly. And if you guys want a good laugh, Google Bill Gates in Doom 1995, and you can see that video in very low resolution of Bill Gates kind of awkwardly saying that, you know, Windows is the platform that you're going to want to play Doom and other games on. He was right, but it was an awkward start at best.
It's just different. It speaks to the era. I do want to ask you, has it changed a lot? Because I mean, and I think we touched on this before the show started, but back then you could do anything. Like, from a business point of view, I'm sure, you know, Larry, you have a different, you know, perspective of then to now. Yep. It is so sophisticated, so controlled, maybe a little too much today versus that era back then, but people, it felt like anything would go back then.
Well, I think, Gordon, to your point, I would actually argue that, you know, certainly we're talking about 1995, and Kel, you actually have thrown down the gauntlet, because I am actually really good friends with the team who runs Microsoft Archives, who has amazing stuff. I mean, this stuff would blow. We should do a show from there sometimes. But I'm going to send them an email and see if they have anything from this legendary event, including your beverage. but to your
point, Gordon, jalapeno flavored, that I remember.
but to your point, I would actually say that certainly they changed 20 years. They've actually changed in the past 5 years. Events have gotten dramatically different in 5 years in terms of the games industry is so much more inclusive now. You know, 10 years ago, it was kind of the same old as it was the 5 years before. But in the past 5 or 6 years, the inclusivity and the diversity has just been incredible. In terms of who gaming now appeals to and who we're trying to appeal to as well.
And the age range is huge. It's not just for, you know, old guys with money.
Well, no, I also, you know, it's funny you say that, 'cause I was thinking about, have you guys ever chatted with Shirley Curry? She's the 85 year old grandma who plays Skyrim. She, you know, that's to your point, that's at the other end of the spectrum, but these, you know, gaming, as we've learned at Xbox, you know, gaming's universal. When I go out into the public and I'm talking to people who are gamers, usually I have a spouse or a partner with them. Like, I don't really play games. And I ask them, like, well, let's take a look at your phone. Oh, I've got this on there. It turns out they are gamers. It's just the definition of what a gamer is means something different to a lot of different people. Everybody plays games. My mother plays games. My wife plays. Everybody plays games to a certain degree.
Yeah, I agree. My wife logs way more hours than me, but it's all on her phone. So
right.
But yeah, I think the market has changed drastically. I mean, to what Larry said, it's the diversity is very broad now. And I think a big part of it is because gaming is just so accessible. Yeah. You know, those problems that we faced with PC gaming little by little started to get innovated and resolved. You know, Microsoft, huge leap forward for the entire industry with DirectX. You know, back then patching games was a big problem. Getting games was a big problem. Like Larry talked about having to go to the store. And compatibility was a big issue. I remember when Steam first came out from Valve and how controversial that was. And the idea that you would download your games over the internet and they would be automatically patched for you. And just how resistive the industry was to that whole, I'm not going to put a piece of software that runs all the time on my computer. But then people were saying that Valve was going to track them and all these horrible things, right? And now it's pretty much exclusively how we get our games. Then computers themselves started to get more affordable because instead of needing to have every single PCI slot taken up and having to have all these disk drives, you know, companies like Intel, AMD, NVIDIA, they started integrating more and more and more into the chipset and into the processor and into the motherboard. And now most PCs, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, Kelt, they only have like a graphics card populated by and large in terms of a PCI Express slot. Everything else is integrated into the motherboard somehow, some way. That reduced cost, that reduced complexity considerably. And then a lot of innovations occurred as well. We haven't even gotten into the whole console versus PC war that occurred, right? But then when Microsoft came on with Xbox and everybody was talking about the death of PC gaming because of just how much innovation Microsoft brought to gaming. And they kind of took the best of PC, in my opinion, and the best of console, solved a ton of problems, brought them together and built the direct Xbox, right? And it put PC on notice in a lot of ways. And then PC had to re-innovate a bunch of stuff or start innovating again.
I'll back you up on that one.
Thanks, buddy. PC had to kind of innovate again to save itself. And it's just like, we came so far in solving all these problems. And I think as we did that, it just started getting more accessible. Prices got lower, the complexity, the barriers of entry, all these things started getting simpler, easier, and it became more and more appealing to more and more people. And you didn't have to be an IT professional anymore to be able to figure out how to get a game to work on your PC. And then, like Larry talked about, you know, you asked people, what apps do you have on your phone? Then tablets and phones and all these things suddenly made it even that much more accessible because you don't even have to be at your TV or at your computer anymore to play games. Like that's how we used to have to play games, is where is there a TV or where is there a computer? Now they're with you, you know, on 24/7, which sounds bad actually, but they're in your pocket with you pretty much anywhere. And if you want to fire up a game of anything as simple as chess online to, I don't know, something PUBG or I don't know, whatever. I don't play mobile games right now, but whatever is the most popular mobile game out there, you have like this whole world of games accessible in your pocket, which is pretty amazing.
You know, to your point, Frank, you know, we talked about the accessibility and it's something we've seen. And I had the pleasure of working with a lot of these innovators in the early days of Xbox when I first started. But we've seen so much change with the models. You talked about Steam and Gabe and his team have done a tremendous work over there of normalizing and accepting this concept of digital games. But beyond that, we also saw, you know, we've done some work in that space with like with PC Game Pass. Instead of worrying about, oh, does this, am I going to like this game? And we think about it this way with like Game Pass, where you pay a subscription, you get access to over 100 games and more, is you know, it changes the conversation from what should I buy to what should I play? And because you have access to all these games. So that's one thing that we're really focused on. And then build on top of that, we have streaming. So to your point, in your pocket, you now have Halo Infinite that you can play or get your dailies in Apex or any of these other types of games. So we're just extending the concept and it all builds off of PC, to your point. Everything that Xbox is today is as a result of all those people that Kelt mentioned in that garage back in the day in Windows 95.
I still like to refer to consoles as the gateway drug, and we like to, especially for the younger crowd. You know, they may start gaming on a phone nowadays, whereas they used to start on console. But they're now, you know, moving to PC eventually. But Larry, what you were saying is exactly right. It's now the title is with the, you know, Xbox Game Pass, a PC Game Pass. The title is universal. It's really, you know, how much hardware do you want to throw at it? How good do you want it to look? Right. And it's a very familiar experience to the gamer, and it's just so much easier these days and more inclusive.
Yeah, and to the point, one more thing is I know that, you know, we talked about Windows 95, but the Windows team, like with Windows 11, they've done amazing and incredible work about games is still part of their remit and making games run great on whatever version of Windows you have.
I do want to ask you, because Frank touched on it a little bit earlier, but, you know, the when the Xbox came out, it was the, you know, the new sibling. Mm-hmm. The PC was, PC gaming was, you know, the older sibling, and you know, any household, you only care about the baby. And it did feel like for many years there was this tension in the family, but I feel like now it's very different now. I mean, because you know, before it used to be we were always at odds, but you know, Microsoft very much is, you know, you have Xbox, you either play games on Xbox or you play it on your PC, and it feels like the family is getting along much better now, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, oh, without a doubt. I mean, when, you know, what Phil Spencer's done, we talks about when everybody plays, we all win. That's we take that very to heart. And whether you're playing on your console, whether you're playing on your PC, a great example of that is one of my favorite peripherals is the Xbox Adaptive Controller, which was built from the ground up to work both on console and PC for folks that need a little extra something. And this is an incredible device that I'm so proud of what the team has done with this. And this crosses the bridge. It doesn't matter whether it works on console or PC. We just want people to play games. That's the most important thing.
I agree, Larry, but it didn't always feel that way.
No.
Very honestly, I think Phil has done a phenomenal job of changing the culture because prior to working with him, it felt a lot like it was all about for Microsoft, the Xbox and Xbox gaming. And it felt that way, at least as a PC provider. I always felt like, you know, there was actual competition going on, and got a chance to meet with Phil a long time ago and hear his strategy and his vision. And he's executed it exceptionally well. And it has been all about now, how does everybody play games? It's like, it feels like, I mean, just the strides that have been made around backwards compatibility on consoles, which was a huge feature benefit of PC, and then having cross-platform games as well, and having a lot of the Xbox games run on Windows and vice versa. And I mean, we're night and day different today than we were, you know, 15 or so years ago whenever it was that the Xbox came out. And what I've found is that more and more gamers, we started to see it like 10 years ago, but nowadays people play the games more than they play the devices. And when they want to play a game that's best formatted for a TV, there's nothing better than a console. Trust me, I've tried and failed miserably with the Steam machine to play anything on a TV better than a console. Right? But when it comes to playing at a PC or on a monitor setting at a 2-foot experience, that closer 2-foot experience like we're all in right now, I'm going to say I think PC is the best that's out there to do it. And because each one of those devices has done such a great job of catering to that use case. I think they continue to dominate those games, those genres, those environments as much as they do. And I think they're both thriving as a result of that. And the truth is I think a console industry without a PC gaming industry wouldn't be as far ahead as it is today, and vice versa. I think just in general, competition's good, and it's what's gotten us to where we are today.
You know, you talked about the moment ago about it. You felt like this PC was maybe a second-class citizen. That may have been the case back in the day, and certainly it's not anymore. But I think it also because our business has evolved, and you've seen, we talk about Game Pass and things like this. We're about getting people to play games wherever they want to. Do you want to play on a mobile device? Do you want to play on a PC monitor? Do you want to play on a big TV? and how do you want to play? That's why a lot of the development for PC gaming, like in Windows 11, we've got the controller bar and HDR work. All of that work comes from what we did on the console. And a lot of what we've done on Windows goes back in the console. So it's to your point, Phil has done an amazing job of forging forward, of just letting people play games where they are. And that's what it's all about. He wants everybody to play games. That's it.
Everybody's a multi-platformer these days, it feels like.
Yeah.
You know, they have a Steam Deck. They've got a console in the living room. They've got their PC, and you got your phone, right? Yeah. You just play whatever you're going to play. So,
well, now, as of today, you can play Steam in your Tesla even.
Really?
Yeah. They announced today that they're putting Steam games on Tesla vehicles. I mean, that's how far we've come as an industry, which is pretty absurd. If you ask me, like, who would have ever imagined, not much like cars that would have gotten to where they are now, but that you can actually play full-blown PC games in a car. That's the power of gaming. Like, that's how far we've come from these obscure garages and this closetness that we were talking about earlier, where you're just afraid to tell people that you're playing games and you're going to be judged. And I mean, I was in school when a lot of this was coming up, and I had three friends that played games, and we were the nerds and we were the outcasts and we were the embarrassed ones, right? And the teachers would call one of us when one of the computers in the classroom was broken. And keep in mind, the classroom only had one computer inside of the entire classroom, right? And now, I mean, how far we've come that cars now have games integrated into them natively. It's whether the relevance of it or not, it's questionable, debatable, all that, but it's just such a huge milestone of progress that is, I think, a moment where, you know, in 5 years and 10 years, do more cars start having games in it? Is that the next gaming platform? Maybe, maybe not. But what a moment in history that just, like, these moments keep coming up. It hasn't gotten boring at all yet. It's still extremely exciting.
Well, to your point, that's you know, I've been at Microsoft for 20 plus years. That's why I'm still here, because I see the stuff we're working on in the future. And I'm like, I want to be part of that. I want to help forge the future. And that's what, you're right. There's, where are we going? Who knows? But it's going to be great.
31 years running Falcon, and honestly, it's the new toys that keep it exciting for me. You know, I just got a new Radeon from Frank, and it's awesome.
Thank you, Kelt. I appreciate that.
And it fits in our micro towers. Yes.
That's a big plus. And Larry, you're, you know, even though you're very much, you're always so associated with the Xbox consoles, you actually are having a new gaming PC. Obviously you've been doing it for a long time. You're a big PC gamer too?
Yeah. I mean, it's the guys, Falcon and AMD, they sent me this amazing, and I wish I could show it to you, but it's sitting on the floor over here. It's this beautiful, I'll put some photos on my Instagram and Twitter, Halo Infinite with the Halo card in it. It's extraordinary. I love PC gaming because, again, to the point of I like to game. Sometimes I want that 2-foot experience. And to be honest with you, sometimes I spend all day at work in front of a machine. I don't want to be 2 feet away. I want to be 10 feet away in front of it, right?
I feel you 100%. Yes. Right?
Last thing you want to do is open up another window on your PC. But, you know, I love being able to test out the latest. And we talked about Steam. They've always got some great indie games up there. And that's such a beehive of activity. And it kind of allows me a glimpse of where the industry is going in some regards in terms of content design decisions. I love PC gaming. And at the end of the day, I mean, I think we've all proved it many times over during this past hour. We're all nerds, right? We all like to roll up our sleeves and see what the latest thing is. I am so excited to boot this PC up and see what it can do and crank everything up to ultra. I'm stoked. It's gamers are gamers. I've been PC gaming for so long before I was ever into consoles. And again, like Frank, we spend all day doing this. Now you want to do a little bit of 10-foot gaming.
Yeah, I suffer from the very same thing. I mean, I'm in front of this this camera and this desk and this monitor that I'm talking to you guys in here 8, 9, 10 hours a day. And I stand. If you notice, I'm always moving because I stand at my desk. I can't sit for too long. My back just can't stand it. So what do I do when I'm done here is I go to what we call, I have two sons and I only have two sons. So my wife is severely outnumbered here, but we have the bro lounge where the guys go and we hang out and we play Xbox or, you know, we play board games, we play chess, or they have a whole Lego center over there. But I sit down in a recliner and I'll sit there and I'll play. And it's a change of environment now. I can sit back. I'm not standing anymore. I can get maybe an hour or so of gaming. And what I've been doing lately is playing old games on the Xbox.
Tell me what you're playing, Frank.
What's the boxing game?
I need you to check out Vampire Survivors. It's a newer game, but it's 8-bit. It's unbelievable.
I will check it out. I'm not going that old. I'm not going. I'm going to Xbox 360 games. So yeah. I was playing Fusion Frenzy the other day because it took me back, you know, to the original Xbox. And then what's the boxing one that's super old too?
KO Boxing.
It looks the graphics are incredible. I can't believe it's a 2-generation old game. Fight it was Night? On Game Pass.
Fight Night.
Yes, Fight Night.
Yeah, Fight Night.
I think you guys just removed it from Game Pass like a few weeks ago or so. I was playing that, beat that whole game, which was incredible. But I love being able to go back to some of the other games because I didn't get to play them back when they were relevant.
Well, you know
they're on my list of games to play, and I didn't like that time didn't pass me anymore like it would have, you know, prior to backwards compatibility.
What you're talking about, Frank, is something that Phil talks about frequently, and that is preserving the art of games, which, and what we've seen, we've had someone, this happened to somebody at work, and it hasn't happened to me yet. Because my daughter's a little too young, but somebody booted up with Xbox 360, booted up an old Xbox 360 game, and there was a game save from 2006, and they just picked up and kept playing, and they were able to play and enjoy that experience with their son and or their daughter. So they're now sharing this game history that the parent had or the parents had with their family. And it sounds a little bit like what you're doing.
That's funny you mentioned that. I'm trying to get a Rock Band 4 set because I want my kids to go through the Rock Band experience. We had so much fun playing Rock. This is turning into a console fan thing. Guys, I swear to you, I'm a 95% PC gamer. I'm true. But there's some good console memories as well. And anyways, people want a lot of money for Rock Band 4, by the way, on the gray market. They want like $200 plus for a set, and they're beaten up and they're beat to crap. But I think 5 is coming out. It was announced to come out in 2023, so I'm holding out for that. But I want to do that now with my kids. I got a 10 and a 13-year-old, and now they're like of age where they can, you know, not play the guitar, but play the Rock Band guitar and do the drums. And I want to share that experience with them. But if I did buy Rock Band 4, I know it would work.
If you have any three-person songs that are good in Rock Band, drop it in the chat, please, so that Frank can take a look at it for his band.
You know, does anybody have any recommendations? Because I love your idea, but my household, no surprise, we're pretty much PC gamers. It's either mobile gamers or PC gamers.
Nobody's perfect.
I can play with my two kids, but that I don't suck at.
I can tell you, you will need two kids to help you get through Elden Ring. So Elden Ring on PC, I finished it. I've got like 200 hours in it, but some of those boss battles, I mean, I actually have kind of a wound right here and my middle mouse button is broken from Elden Ring. And were it not for my children being so much better and having such better reflexes than me, I would not have finished Elden Ring. So yeah, your children these days, they, you know, you get old enough, they help you through your PC accomplishments.
You all play as a band, like you're. Yes. I love that idea.
You summon your children when you need help. Put down your summoning sign on the floor. A 13-year-old appears and will help you kill Melania.
Was that moment? Do you remember the moment, Kelt, where your kids demonstrated that they were now the superior gamers in your household? It wasn't you anymore.
It was the day after I got them their PCs.
That was quick.
I wish I was joking. I've been playing Terraria, which is a little 8-bit sort of I guess Minecraft 2D
simmy kind of thing. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. With my younger son, and we got to the point where he was so far out ahead of me, I just couldn't keep up anymore. We couldn't go to the same levels anymore.
Well, you know, it's interesting, Kel, because this is just part of the younger generation who grew up on screens, and they grew up on multitasking, and they grew up on the ability to modify their environment. I've said this many times because, of course, Microsoft, we own Minecraft. Minecraft is the playground of this generation. When everybody on this call grew up, we were at the playground, and if we got out of line, you know, somebody cracked us in the head or pushed us off the seesaw or what have you. In Minecraft, they kick you off the server or don't give you rights, right? It's just, it's the new playground, and that's where they're learning some of the, and now they can build the, you know, you and I could build a sandcastle in the playground, but in their playground, they can build the monument. They can build whatever they want. It's extraordinary. It's just interesting how the younger audience has grown up with these digital tools.
Yeah. It's for me, it was Fortnite a few years ago when it first came out. It was really like the, other than Minecraft and Roblox, it was really like the first, you could say, kind of violent first person shooter that I let them play, even though it's pretty subdued, the violence. But I'm like destroying them, schooling them all. That lasted about 2 weeks. And then we got into a match and they did like a custom map, 1v1, a third party custom map.
1v1 me, bro.
Yeah. And then they were laughing at me. And at that point, it was like, all right, let's play something else. I'm trying to scramble to find another game. Let's do Mortal Kombat. And I'm, you know, I beat him for like the first four or five times in Mortal Kombat, and then I couldn't beat him again. And it's incredible, like to Kelly and Larry's, their experience. It just took them hours to become dominant versus me. I mean, it took me decades to get to this point. Yeah. You know, it's pretty bad. So now we don't play because I hold them back. We don't play Fortnite anymore because I hold them back. I'm the loser. I got to figure something out so we can play a team based or squad or something. I'm not going to play against them because then it'll just destroy my self-esteem. So
I just get too upset when I play these days because I don't like to lose. And that's just,
yeah.
It's just, yeah, don't play Elden Ring then. Don't.
You know, I do want to steer it back to PC talk. I know we're getting near the end here, but
yeah.
What is everybody's, if you could pick through your entire history with gaming, PC gaming, all gaming, because we're clearly that we're going to talk about all games. What is your favorite piece of hardware from all that time? Like, what was the thing that, like, you think about with a smile? I think, like, the thing that's like, oh, that just made it so special. So, like, could be favorite PC entirely, or could be like maybe RGB kind of like changed your life.
I remember a very distinct, the best hardware demo I ever got. I got a call from a guy named Ross Smith from a company I'd never heard of called 3DFX. And best early beta demo I'd ever seen. He's just like, I've got something to send you. Tell me if you like it. That was the pitch. And this 3DFX board showed up along with the first 3D beta of a game called Tomb Raider, which I'd never heard of before. And I think like that and kind of like, you know, your first experience in virtual reality, those are the kind of like watershed, I've seen the future moments. And yeah, 3DFX, you know, the first 3D accelerator really for the kids out there when 3D wasn't a thing that all graphics cards could do, that was kind of mind-blowing. And of course Tomb Raider was, you know, a huge hit as well, and I think 3DFX kind of helped that. You know, you were an elite gamer if you could do the 3DFX version of Tomb Raider,
right?
But that was the coolest, just try this and see the future demo I can remember in hardware.
What about Larry or Frank?
I think this is Larry. I think when I think back, and I don't have one with me and I should get one, and it's so simplistic, but it meant so much to me, was the original Atari joystick. It was a simple stick. It had one button. And I just remember that being so brilliant. And I love that so much. And so because one of my first games I ever laid my hands on was Pong, which of course had dials, but then this to me was just so different because I played a game called Star Raiders, which was from the early 80s. I used to go into the high school computer lab early. I'd beg them to, who goes to school early? This guy would beg to go in early and open up the lab. And I remember because I would buy the teacher the newspaper and a coffee, and he would sit there and read the paper while I was playing the game. That was kind of the give and take. So I remember being transported into another world with that simple joystick was just, to me, magical. Because that's the only thing it ever did. You couldn't do anything else with it. By itself, it was useless. you know, with a keyboard, you can do other things. You can play games and type emails, but this thing was single purpose. So I just remember that so vividly. And that was the moment that I said, this is the future.
It kind of makes me pine for a modern day USB version of it. I'm sure somebody's made one, but
right.
recreation of the original 26 inch joystick. That, of course, it wouldn't break after 3 weeks.
Yeah, that's all other thing. I had a lot of them.
All right, Frank, what about you?
I'm not sure if I got the name correct. All right. So I apologize if I didn't. But when I was really young, my brother-in-law had the first computer in a home that I ever experienced. Like, he had a computer for work at his house. And he also had a laptop for work back then. But it wasn't really a laptop. It was what those things used to be, right? And there was a game that was the first multiplayer game I ever experienced. It was a flying game. I think it was called F-29 Retaliator or F-22 Retaliator. Something. I was trying to Google it to see if I could find it now. But you'd dial up together via modem. You'd have a host and you'd have a client, right? And you dialed into one computer from the other computer. And me and my nephew would sit there and we would dogfight each other in this game. And it's two computers connected to one another. And that was the first time I experienced a computer-to-computer multiplayer experience. Because before that, it had always been Atari. You're both sharing one screen, right? And that game just stands out to me because I was like, this is one of the most fun experiences I'm ever having because I'm playing with somebody else, but we're in two different rooms in the house and it was a fight. It was just a flying game and your dog. It was just a moment that left an impression on me. Like, this is an absolute blast. Granted, I was like 10 or 11 years old, 12 years old. No idea that what the internet was, how it would emerge, how it would transform gaming. But it was an impressive time that it left an impression on me that I just thought, man, this is so much fun. This is more fun than any other, like, and I didn't even know what local multiplayer was at that time, right? Like, you know, two gamepads on a TV. That it just left a huge impression. And I think that's why multiplayer gaming is because it is just so much fun, has taken off as much as it has. I mean, it is the predominant way to game nowadays, I think, on at least on PC.
Yeah, the human adversary or the teammate is just, we haven't gotten to the point where AI is going to take over for that yet, but playing against another human is always the ultimate challenge, it feels like. So I can get that. So
I remember my first multiplayer experience as well. You mentioned that, Frank. I remember distinctly it was either F-15 Strike Eagle 2 or 3. And I was actually playing it over modem to now Falcon's VP, and we were both in F-15s, playing co-op, going to bomb something. I remember, you know, panning over to, it wasn't VR, you had to, you know, physically move the joystick to look out the window, and there was another F-15 with a human piloting it, and that was a watershed moment. So I know exactly that feeling of like, wow, I've never seen anything like that before. We're gonna go play together and bomb something.
See, Kel, your flight school background did help out.
Yes.
There you go. Tell your parents you're in the simulator. You're in the simulator training for combat.
Yep.
But I remember it, and you know, this is 30 something years ago, but I remember it being a smooth experience. Like, there wasn't a bunch of lag. There wasn't a bunch of issues. The graphics didn't look like they look today, but back then that's the best we had ever seen. So it was incredible back then to see but I remember being a very positive experience. But to your point, Gordon, about like NPCs and AI, like that's obviously all going to emerge. But there's something about knowing the person that you're playing with or against and just having a respectful taunting with them. You know, like the anonymous people that you play with online, there's like disrespectful taunting, and it kind of makes it undesirable to play. But when you know the other person, it's like this poking and this prodding and this teasing, and you know you're going to face them, so you're not going to like do, you know, horrible, disgusting joke commentary to them or anything. And just that kind of gameplay, which eventually led to LAN parties, which is something I kind of miss, honestly, because that was, again, there was respect and, you know, there was a different environment of, I'm in a physical presence. If I piss the person off next to me too much, they can actually punch me. So I'm not going to do something like that.
And they did.
Or they did, right? But that was really cool too. You met so many cool people and you got to see their PCs. A lot of ideas for PC designs and stuff came from us going to LAN parties and just looking at what other people were doing and saying, yeah, man, that would be really cool if we could productize that. I miss that. I miss that stuff.
Gordon, do you remember the LAN party on the Hornet aircraft carrier, the aircraft carrier behind you that NVIDIA yes. put on? Yes. That was one of the more fun events that that gaming has ever had. But yeah, LAN party in an aircraft carrier.
I do miss LAN parties. They are just, especially the ones that go to like the 24-hour ones. I'm too old for that now, but it is such a blast.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did, after about 16 hours, it didn't smell that good. But
we had fun. We had fun. Yeah,
they were a lot of fun.
Gosh, you know, I could go on for hours and hours and hours, but I know I got to end it because people got to actually do their day jobs, unfortunately. Too bad, you know, we can't get our companies just to pay to have us do this all day. But I really want to thank you for coming on the show and talking about this because it's just so exciting to think how far we've come. And you look back, you just turn your head back around, you look at that road that goes on for, you know, 30 years. And there were some difficult moments here, but we've gotten here. And, you know, as much as everybody still wants to argue, it does feel like, you know, we're legitimate. All gamers are, you know, it's an accepted thing now. I just kind of love this talk.
Yeah, I mean,
I wonder where we'll be in 20 more.
Right,
come so far.
Can we put this on the calendar for 20 years from today, and we'll have the same conversation?
We will all be in a nursing home together,
having a great LAN party,
misremembering things.
Ed over at Sapphire, is a graphics card maker. He's always suggested, like, he's always said, like, I'm going to make a retirement home. But it's going to be for old gamers.
Yeah.
Because it's going to have like a LAN party area and, you know, all the games set up. And
right.
You could retire there and just play games against other older folks who play games.
Just live out your golden years having fun.
I mean, when I have that much time on my hands, honestly, that's going to be one of the things I'm going to do. There's a lot of games I haven't been able to play all the way through. A lot of shows I haven't been able to see all the way through.
So is your stack of shame become your stack of retirement now? Is that what you're saying?
He's saving it for later.
Pretty much. Just don't lose backwards compatibility. Please.
Noted.
Or I'll just have to keep all my old consoles. Oh, man. But yeah, that's actually a really cool idea, Gordon. That'll be fun.
The old folks retirement home where it's just all gaming all the time. Board games, console, PC, whatever you want, portable.
We'll connect all the homes around the country and around the world, right?
Oh my gosh. It's an entire franchise. You sort of like you connect them and you'd have to have, so they'd have to have comfortable. So the problem is gaming chairs, not that good, but if you get a good, you know, like easy, you know, the lazy boy.
No, we're going to need gaming wheelchairs by then.
Oh,
yeah.
And then high speed internet to all of them, you know?
Well, here's what I'm going to do. While you guys are doing all of that, I'm going to set up cameras and live streams because I want to see all the old people taunting each other and cursing at each other and getting into fights and saying, I'm going to kick your ass. I want to kick because there's few things are funnier than seeing that. So
it will never change. I'm sure we'll be exactly the same.
I remember Leroy Jenkins. He was a friend of mine.
Does anybody know what happened to Leroy by any chance?
I actually worked with somebody who was in that raid party.
Really?
Yeah, he tells the story. I don't really want to talk too much about it, but I'll just say he has some interesting behind the scenes stories about that, about Leroy.
Still one of the greatest internet moments ever.
That is just a natural moment though, because I play games where it's not even like they're emulating Leroy Jenkins. It was like it'll be like there's always somebody wants to YOLO it. It's like, why are you doing this? You know, like you're. You're reducing our resources by just rushing up the middle and getting killed here, but yet you are doing it again.
Anyway, Leroy Jenkins.
That was awesome.
Can't be helped. It's human nature. There's definitely somebody at a university needs to study the things that happen in games and how they're actually tied to human evolution. Like, I'm sure there was like...
Or de-evolution.
Yeah, like probably 4 million years ago, like, okay, we got to take this T-Rex. Of course, they weren't T-Rexes.
We got to take the mastodon down.
Yeah, but somebody was like, I'm going. It's like, no, wait. And they did it. They rushed off to take that Macedon down by themselves. And it didn't
And then
work
the
out.
One in a billion that survived in doing it is a hero, and we built monuments and statues for.
The one time it worked. Oh, I hate that, because everyone's like, don't do it, don't do it. Oh, it actually worked. Oh, yeah. I can't say anything now. So
and we're all descended from that guy, which is why we all kind of want to do it.
Oh my God, maybe we are. It's in our DNA. But fantastic. This is a blast. I really got to let you go because I'm going to get yelled at here. So thanks, gang. Anyway, I want to say bye to everybody. Check back next week for your fix of PC talk on the Full Nerd. I'm going to go from box again, according to the boxes on my screen. Thank you for coming. You know him and love him. Major Nelson, Larry Hyrb, just got his brand new Falcon Northwest system with a Halo video card in it. That's crazy. We're gonna
follow me on Instagram or Twitter and you can see updates on that.
I definitely want to see that. And down in my other box, I have AMD's Frank Azor, and of course goes all the way back to Alienware.
Hey, thanks for having us, guys. This was a lot of fun, really. Would love to do it in 20 years.
I could go on for another 4 hours of this. This is like, I wish we could. And of course we have the OG of PC gaming machines, Kelt Reeves of Falcon Northwest.
Thanks, Gordon. And I know OG just means old guy, but I appreciate it anyways.
Pretty much. We are, because we are old guys. And of course, Adam Patrick Murray is going to hit the off switch here.
Thanks, everybody. This was awesome. We'll definitely do it again. We'll see you later. Bye.
Thanks.